Tantor, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Overmountain Men by Cameron Judd. Narrated by Joshua Saxon. Prologue. Joshua Byram knelt where slanting rays of morning sun, piercing through the open cabin door, touched the dirt floor of the house of Wahili Tikwalitsi. Before him lay a naked, sweat-drenched Cherokee boy swaddled in trade blankets, and in the boy's left hand was a wing feather of a hawk. In Wahili's house this breezy Sunday morning, October 19th, 1760, the smell of illness was almost as strong as that of the heavy wood smoke rising toward the roof hole from the dying central fire. Joshua had wrinkled his nose at the sickly stench the moment he ducked inside the door. Now he looked around the cabin, letting his eyes recover from the brilliant autumn sun and adjust to the dimmer interior light. He squeezed the crude rawhide grip of his flint knife tightly, swallowed with a sandy throat, and wondered if he would have either the opportunity or the courage to do what he had come to do. At the moment, all was relatively quiet in the Cherokee village of Tikwalitsi. The pervading stillness was broken only by barking dogs, wind-borne voices, rustling trees, and the steady, distant thump of a squaw's wood pestle on a corn mortar hollowed from a hickory log. 10-year-old Joshua had sneaked through the town's mix of log summer houses, earth-covered winter hot houses, corn cribs, food shelters, and gardens filled with dead vines and brown stalks, and settled in a hidden place to watch the house of Wahili, known to the white men as the Bloody Eagle of Tikwalitsi. Only when he saw the warrior's wife leave to gather firewood by the river did he go to the cabin and enter. No one had seen him, and he had not expected that anyone would. Joshua was proudly aware of his inborn ability to travel silently and unseen, and on this, his chosen day of vengeance, the skill had served him well. But now he was bewildered. He had heard talk of sickness in the house of Bloody Eagle, and it had been his understanding that it was the warrior himself who was ill. Apparently that was not true, for Bloody Eagle was not here. Joshua wondered if the warrior might be in his winter house trying to sweat away his illness, but a glance outside revealed no smoke rising from the conical winter house. Obviously it was this boy, not Bloody Eagle himself, who was ill, and Joshua had simply misunderstood. Joshua looked closely at the sleeping Indian's face. The youth's thick hair and smooth brow were sodden. Despite his dark, almost olive skin, the Cherokee looked wan and wasted, and each breath obviously required effort. He trembled slightly as he slept, the tremors evident in the shaking of the hawk's feather held against his chest. Joshua wondered if the feather had medical or spiritual significance, for he knew the Cherokee's respect for the great Lanuas. Those mighty hawks of legend, the storyteller said, had destroyed the serpentine water-dwelling Uktina, a fearsome creature in which even the white traders firmly believed. Maybe the feather made reference to them for some reason, or maybe it had simply blown in the door, and the sick boy had picked it up idly or unconsciously in his writhings. Joshua felt an unexpected surge of pity and was displeased. Over these past many weeks, he had striven to erase such soft feelings. If he yielded to them, he feared, they would render him unable to do the grim task he felt his duty, the task he had come here to do. But Joshua's pity for the boy, whom he now recognized as the orphaned nephew of Bloody Eagle, the only son of the pox-scarred warrior's sister, would not subside. Joshua grew angry with himself. That a kinsman, a Bloody Eagle of all men, should so affect him was intolerable. Joshua had much cause to hate Bloody Eagle. That warrior, in conjunction with the great chief Okanostota, had been a main instigator of the recent long siege of Fort Loudon. Because of that siege, Joshua had suffered much and lost much, and he would not forget or forgive it. Joshua turned to see the familiar scalp lock that hung on a post outside Bloody Eagle's door and let the dried and painted clump of flesh and windblown hair restir his hatred. He looked down at the knife he had secretly chipped out over the past month from a long shard of flint and mentally repeated the vow he had made a few weeks before on a bloody field as a jubilant bloody eagle tauntingly slapped in his face that same gruesome scalp that now stirred in the wind outside. He had sworn that he would slay and scalp Bloody Eagle, even at the cost of his own life. Since then, he had repeated the vow to himself until he lost all doubt he could fulfill it. Now, though, Joshua was not so confident. Bloody Eagle's unexpected absence threw matters out of balance. If I'm wise, Joshua thought, I will leave and await another opportunity. The idea seemed temptingly sensible, yet Joshua was reluctant to follow it. It had taken too long to build up his courage to make even this attempt. He doubted he would be able to do so again. Then, a new possibility suddenly came to mind. He could achieve his vengeance, even with Bloody Eagle absent. After all, would not the best revenge be to slay the son of the warrior's sister, the youth who under Cherokee practice was the responsibility chiefly of Bloody Eagle as maternal uncle? The thought made Joshua's heart race. Fighting away his lingering sense of pity, he lifted the stone blade high, holding it in both hands. For several moments he was gripped by a strange paralysis and could not move or breathe. But with a great forcing of his will, he finally brought down the knife. At the last second he faltered, averting the blade to the side. The flint blade stuck into the dirt floor and snapped at the center. At the same time, the long, strained wall shoring up Joshua's emotions also broke, and against his will, he began to cry. Now he did not feel like the brave and vengeful man he had wanted to be, but like the frightened captive child he truly was. The idea of more revenge and violence no longer held any appeal. He had seen more than enough of both these past months. Ashamed of his crying, Joshua quickly dried his tears on the sleeve of his homespun shirt. Picking up the pieces of his knife, he tucked them inside the pocket formed by the shirt where it draped over the cloth sash round his thin waist. When he looked again at the Indian boy, he was surprised to see the sunken eyes tremble open and the face turn toward him. The Cherokee initially stared listlessly at Joshua, then looked afraid as he realized this was a stranger, and a white one at that. For many moments, the two boys looked at each other in silence, each fearing the other. Finally, Joshua lifted his head haughtily and tried to sound gruff and manly when he spoke. "I am Ioninni, the swimmer," he said, slapping his right hand across his chest. "I am very brave and strong." Joshua was proud of the Cherokee name by which Atakulakula, whom the whites called Little Carpenter, had called him. Using it made Joshua feel more courageous, more a part of the world in which he was now forced to live. Though his status as a prisoner in the Cherokee's world was new to him, that world itself was not. He had lived among the Overhill Cherokee for 3 years, since he and his mother had accompanied his father and Henry Dory across the mountains as they delivered cannon from Fort Prince George to Fort Loudon. Life had brought many traumatic changes since that time. Fort Loudon had fallen, and most of its officers had been killed. The cannon had been seized and taken to the Cherokee's sacred city of Chota. And Joshua and the other surviving Fort Loudon refugees had been imprisoned in various Cherokee towns, facing the rescue by ransom, a netherworld existence as Cherokee slaves, or death. The Indian boy's lips moved. His voice was a feverish whisper as he haltingly tried to voice his name. "Tsan, Tsanta." He got no further. That the young Cherokee was sick nearly to the point of death seemed evident to Joshua. Another unwanted surge of pity arose, threatening to bring the tears out of his eyes again. He could not understand his emotions or what had aroused them. Joshua's next action was pure impulse, surprising even himself. Reaching back beneath his loose-fitting shirt, over his head he pulled a deer-hide thong that had encircled his neck. On the thong hung an ancient coin with strange words engraved. "Antonius Augustus Pius, Princeps Pontifex Tertio Consule." Of the words on the other side, only two were legible. "Aurelius Caesar." The coin was one of the few things that Jack Byram had ever given his son, The trader had obtained the trinket years ago through barter with the recently deceased Cherokee leader, Condecorte, called Old Hop by the whites. The ancient Indian had told Byram that the coin had been found with others like it beside a river to the west. Byram had given the coin to his son in a moment of affection, and because such gestures from Byram were rare indeed, Joshua had guarded the coin closely, finding an inexplicable reassurance and comfort in feeling its cool face lying against his chest. But now he held it up for the Cherokee boy to see, then reached across and placed it in his hands. "For you," Joshua said in a slightly choked voice, "to help you live." He was surprised at himself as soon as he had done it, amazed he cared what happened to the sick boy. But care he did. The Cherokee clutched the coin and breathed loudly, his eyes closing again. Joshua rose, wiped his face again on his sleeve, and turned to go, thinking the Indian was asleep once more. He wondered if the boy, whose mumbled name he had interpreted as Tisani, would ever remember where the coin had come from, if he lived to consider the matter at all. Joshua had reached the door when the boy made a guttural sound. Looking back, Joshua saw the Indian was trying to give him a gift in return. It was the hawk feather held loosely in his uplifted hand. Joshua knelt again and accepted it. The Cherokee had presented him the only thing he had to give. And to the already emotional Joshua, the gesture was deeply touching. "I accept your gift," he said, trying to hide his emotions by talking the haughty style he had heard his father use in bartering with the Cherokee. "And because it is the feather of a hawk, to me you will be Tsani Lanua, John Hawk." The Indian did not respond. His eyes closed again. For a frightful moment, Joshua thought John Hawk had died, but then the trouble breathing started anew. Joshua rose again, slipped out of the cabin. Outside the door, he paused and looked up at the scalp lock and felt ashamed. Jack Byram would surely have scorned his son for this failure. The traitor had always believed in calculated revenge, believed in it even more strongly, if that was possible, than the Cherokees he served and cheated. Joshua had been raised to believe that every blow deserved one in turn. Today, he had been untrue to that belief. He was sure that what he had done was not right. By rights, he should have killed Bloody Eagle's sick nephew instead of giving him a gift and name. No kinsman of Bloody Eagle deserved mercy. Wahili of Tikwalitsi certainly knew nothing of mercy. He was reputed to be a heartless and cruel killer. In the Cherokee towns and even in Fort Loudoun, Joshua had heard many tales of the pockmarked warrior's brutality toward the white race that had brought smallpox to the Ani Yunwiya, as the Cherokees called themselves, leaving him and many others scarred for life. The Fort Loudoun soldiers had even claimed that the blood-red forehead birthmark that had given Bloody Eagle his designation among the whites was the personal mark of the devils he served. Joshua had never been sure what to make of that tale, for he had known many men, his own father included, who seemed faithful enough servants of the devil without any physical marks to identify them. Somewhere on the other side of Tikwalitsi, the corn mortar continued its thumping and grinding. Beyond a line of brilliantly leaved maple trees, the Teliko River splashed. Joshua set off across the town again, and as he concentrated on stealth, the October wind snatched the hawk feather from his hand and sent it flying through the air with an east-moving shower of golden and crimson leaves. He paused long enough to watch it twist out of sight, then went on. 1. The Overhill Towns. Chapter 1. 3 years and 7 months before Joshua Byram gave the Roman coin to John Hawk, his life was still being lived far from the land of the Overhill Cherokees. And of their ways, he had known nothing but what his father told him on his periodic visits home. And little enough, that was. Jackson Bartholomew Byram had no real affection for the Indians from whom he gouged his livelihood and talked only briefly of them. Byram's homecoming to the little clapboard house outside of Charlestown, South Carolina, inevitably brought a mixture of blessing and tension to Joshua and his mother, Hester Byram. For Hester in particular, they were stressful times, for Byram's habit was to get drunk and then make up for months without access to his wife's physical charms. Hester endured his rough, loveless molestations patiently and silently, even though she knew it was likely that Byram was an unfaithful husband. He probably kept company with a Cherokee woman back across the mountains, the habit of many traders. She never asked him about it, and would not as long as he came home with money in hand, for on that money and what food she could raise, she and Joshua depended for life. As long as Jack Byram provided sustenance, Hester would ask no more of him. And her husband's visits, though trying, were after all brief enough to be endurable. After only a few weeks, sometimes just a few days, Byram would be gone, heading back to the wilderness beyond the mountains, trailing behind him another string of pack horses laden with cheap trade rifles, beads, blankets, ammunition, knives, cloth, mirrors, kettles, and vermilion paint. Hester would watch him go, then kneel and kiss her son. "We have money and all is well," she would say. "We are together again, alone, and that is as it should be." But one morning, Jack Byram rode home again, and matters were different from then on. Joshua was the first to see him return. At age 7, the boy was already showing clear evidence of a special affinity for life outdoors. From dawn until Hester called him in after dark, Joshua spent most of his time outside the clapboard cabin exploring the creek, the fields behind the farmstead, the weed-grown picket fence rows, and the little cave out of which the spring bubbled. From time to time, when he thought of it, he would lift his eyes toward the place where the road emerged between two low hills west of the farmstead and look for the approaching form of his father. Byram's homecomings followed no obvious schedule and could come as often as 3 times or as few as 1 time a year. Usually, Joshua saw nothing but empty road between those hills, or some local rider, wagoner, or pedestrian. On this morning of Thursday, March 19, 1757, however, Joshua saw an approaching horseman that he recognized at once, despite the distance, and a second rider as well. For a full minute he stared, then turned and ran into the house. "He's coming, Mother, and there's another man with him." Hester put down the smock she was stitching and without a word followed her son outside. There was no need to ask to whom he referred. She stood in the front yard, her arm over Joshua's shoulder, and silently watched as Byram rode through the crumbling picket gate. Her eyes trailed up and down the hefty length of her husband, then shifted suspiciously to the hulking, slump-shouldered man with him. Byram nodded at his wife before he dismounted. "Hester," he said, glancing down to Joshua, he said. "Hello, boy. Getting bigger all the time." "I know how to set a rabbit snare," Joshua said, unveiling his latest accomplishment in hopes of praise. Byram did not listen. Dismounting, he waved back toward the big man with him. The latter had a full black beard, the bottom of which dusted his broad chest, the top growing out of his cheeks halfway up to his eyes, making him appear masked. "This is Henry Dory from North Carolina," Byram said. "Him and me's partners together on a special job, and I've come from Fort Prince George to get you and Joshua. Henry, he came along with me for company."
"Get us? Why?" Hester asked.
Byram led his horse to a rainwater rivulet, still filled from a dawn downpour. "I'm taking you and Joshua back with me," he said. "From now on, we'll be together."
"That's good, eh?"
Hester said nothing. Joshua, not sure whether to be excited or horrified by what he had just heard, looked up to his mother for guidance. She did not look back at him, but stared wordlessly across at the western horizon. Henry Dory was only now dismounting.
"It looks like another rain will blow in," she said at last. "Joshua, you help your father and Mr. Dory see to their horses."
She turned and walked back inside the house, having not yet kissed or even touched her husband. Jack Byram put on an expression Joshua could not read and watched her depart, then reached down distractedly to tousle his son's thick nut-brown hair. "Ye big enough to lead this horse into the barn, boy?" "Good. Water it some more and feed it some. I'm gonna go in and talk to your mother." Joshua felt proud to have been given an important job, but a little frightened to be left alone, even for a few moments with the stranger Henry Dory. He watched the big North Carolinian from the corner of his eye. Dory looked down at him, and the black beard parted along the line of his mouth as he grinned. Dory's teeth were yellow and crooked, worn down like those of an ancient dog.
"Think you'll like living among bloody Cherokee, boy?"
He dropped the reins of his horse and let the animal wander away from him to patch and new grass that it immediately began to crop.
Joshua mumbled a meaningless answer and led the horse across the dirt lot toward the barn while Dory filled and lit a long clay pipe he'd pulled from beneath the match coat draped his shoulders. When Joshua came out of the barn, he was shocked to see that Dory was emptying his bladder against the side of the house. He turned and grinned at Joshua as he did so, sending smoke out between his ripe corn teeth. Joshua felt a great burst of disgust, but didn't let it show. He had learned long ago to hide his feelings when his father was home. "That makes man feel better," Dory said. "Put up my horse too, won't you, boy?" Rehitching his French fly trousers, Dory walked around the front of the house. Joshua heard him stomp a mud from his feet onto the porch and swing open, slam a door. Adult voices murmured inside. Dory laughed at something Byram said. Joshua took Dory's horse to the barn and did not come out again for a long time, even after he'd finished tending the animal. Instead, he walked to the open west door of the barn and looked out, staring at the horizon that his mother had, wondering what lay beyond it as he fingered the Roman coin hanging on the cord round his neck. Jack Byram took a long swallow of buttermilk and mopped the remainders of it from his beard onto a sleeve already thick with the residue of prior swipes. A tallow lamp sent pale, weak light across the slab table, which was spread with the remnants of a salt pork and ominous supper. Byram resumed talking as Hester and Joshua listened silently, and Henry Dory picked scraps of meat from between his teeth. He had hardly spoken at all throughout the evening, but he had stared openly at Hester in a way that made Joshua feel defensive toward his mother. "They're building a big diamond-shaped stockade and calling it Fort Loudon after the Earl of Loudon," Byram said. "He's the new commander of all the British soldiers in the colonies or some such. The Cherokees, they're happy as dogs and horse meat finally have a real fort there among them and real soldiers. I'm happy about it, too. Some of those red sides have been talking to the French on the sneak, trying to set up trade with them. We let that happen, and we're finished. The fort will go a long way to keep us and the Cherokee doing good, friendly business. You'll like it there, Hester, don't you worry. Place is crawling with folks besides the Cherokees. South Carolina provincial doing most of the building, and the British regulars keeping it all supervised. Wunakas, the Cherokees call white folk. A lot of soldiers are bringing their families in, so there's other white women, plus all the Cherokee women folk. The man in charge is named DeMare, Captain Raymond DeMare. Regular British and a soldier all the way, put up with a lot from the man who designed the fort, German named DeBrom. The mayor called him a madman to his face one time, and he's right. The mayor and him argued all the time. Got so bad that DeBrom moved out to one of Cherokee towns to give out his orders from mayor. But things are better now. DeBrom is gone. He ran off this past Christmas. The big chief old Hop took calling a warrior who ran away in the night. Joshua asked, "Is it DeBrom who hired you to bring the cannon to the fort?" "No, that's the mayor. Hell, DeBrom didn't even want cannon in the place. But DeMare's ready to pay me and Henry good wages to haul several in from Fort Prince George, though I don't believe he thinks we can really do it. And it's going to be a devil of a job, that's God's truth. The damn things weigh 300 pounds and upward apiece, and there's no way to get a wagon through those mountains. But Henry and me and a string of good pack horses can move them mountains themselves if the money was good enough." Hester spoke for the first time in an hour. "Why must you take me and Joshua with you? Why can't we stay where we are?" Byram's expression made it clear the question was not well taken. "You don't think a family should be together, Hester? You never thought so before now."
Byram's face flushed so that it was evident, even in the feeble lamplight.
"This is not that we should be talking about before a guest, Hester. I'll charge you to keep your mouth shut about such matters."
Hester looked down at her plate. Joshua felt vaguely sick to his stomach. Byram smiled at his son, seeking to relieve the tense atmosphere.
"You think you'd like to be raised among the Redskins, boy?"
Joshua glanced at his mother, then nodded, fearing to do anything else. But there was more than forced agreement in his answer. The truth was that the idea of traveling across the distant mountains and away from this port city area he had always known did have much appeal. Joshua knew little about Indians except that they were reputed to be the finest of woodsmen and hunters. And that was exactly what he hoped to be someday. To live among the Overhill Cherokees would mean exposure to their knowledge and skills, and probably, when he was older, access to their rich hunting grounds.
"See there, Hester? Joshua wants to go," Byram said, and Hester nodded compliantly.
That night, before retiring to the barn, for he had given up his bed to Henry Dory, Joshua found his mother alone behind the house. He crept up to her so silently that she was startled when he touched her arm.
Jack, please, can't you allow me even a moment's peace?
She looked surprised, pleasantly, when she saw it was Joshua.
Joshua said, don't worry about going over the mountains, mother. I'll be with you. And that's the one comfort to me, she said. You're God's blessing in a life that's had few of them.
She knelt so her face was level with Joshua's and smiled at him.
Only 7 years old and already so much a little man, ready to go into the wilderness. What a brave son I have.
Why don't you want to go, mother? Haven't you ever wondered what might be there?
I know what's there. Wilderness and heathens who strip the hair from those they murder. The land across the mountains will be the death of me if I go.
Joshua was chilled.
Don't talk so, mother.
Tears pooled in her eyes.
Forgive me for it, but I can talk no other way. The wilderness is a fearful place for me. I should never have married a man as drawn to it as Jack Byram is.
She stood, drying her tears, and took a deep breath.
But marry Jack Byram I did, and go with him I shall, though I know as well as I know my own name that I shall not return. Now be off to bed. The morning will come early.
That night, Joshua lay awake a long time, thrilled at the thought of the adventure before him, but afraid because of the grim way his mother had spoken. At last he went to sleep, nestling down in his blankets in the barn loft, listening to mice scampering in the straw. After that night, Joshua seldom saw his mother shed tears about the change that had come sweeping into their lives. She became ever more resigned and quiet. Even when Jack Byram went into Charlestown and sold the farmstead, Hester kept her emotions masked. When the family, along with Henry Dory, rode away from their South Carolina home for the last time, Hester did not even look back. The journey across to Fort Prince George, built 4 years earlier, South Carolina's westernmost outpost, was uneventful and finally dull despite Joshua's initial eagerness. The negative impression made upon Joshua by Henry Dory did not mellow with time, and the boy stayed close to his mother, feeling instinctively that the ever-staring Dory was a threat. Arrival at Fort Prince George itself was a time of excitement and welcome respite from long and uninterrupted travel. Even Hester seemed revitalized, but Byram and Dory grew more somber and intense after reaching the fort, for here their real job began, and they knew far better than Hester or Joshua how difficult it would be. Soon enough, it was clear to all. Joshua found the journey to Fort Loudon heartbreaking, for he had inherited his mother's concern for animals, and the method Byram and Dory contrived to carry the cannon proved brutal to the pack horses they purchased. The two traders placed the cannon atop individual pack saddles and lashed them tight with belts around the straining animals' midsections. Then they drove the horses as hard as they could along the 150 miles of narrow mountain trails that led to Fort Loudon. The trails were often almost impossible for the cannon-laden horses to maneuver, and on several occasions a horse would fall, its back snapping with a sickening pop as the heavy cannon shifted. Joshua would cry when that occurred, and Hester would comfort him as his father or Dory shot the hopelessly injured animal and shifted the cannon to a spare horse. Then they would proceed, leaving the carcass to the carrion birds. So went the grueling 6 miles a day journey from its beginning until its welcome end, weeks later. Arrival at Fort Loudon, a large palisaded enclosure that stood on an elevation south of the Little Tennessee River where it met the Tallico River, so overwhelmed Joshua that he almost forgot the rigors of the journey. The fort itself was far more elaborate than Fort Prince George, and Captain Raymond DeMare in his officer's uniform greatly impressed Joshua. DeMare enthusiastically welcomed Byram Dory and their artillery. It was one of the few moments in his life when Joshua was truly proud of his father, despite the horror he still felt at Byram and Dory's brutality to the horses. The cannon had been nailed up with steel spikes and replaced that evening into a large fire to soften the spikes for drilling out. Joshua, watched by his silent mother, danced in his excitement by the fire in the center of the fort, as lively as the sparks the flames spat skyward. Everywhere Joshua looked, he saw amazing things and intriguing people. The British soldiers looked dashing in their Prussian-style uniforms of red coats marked with the facings of the 42nd Regiment. They wore tricorn hats, pipe-clayed white breeches and gaiters. Scores of them circled in the light of the fire, some leaning on their 11-pound brown best muskets and watching the blacksmith tend to the heating of the cannon. Others were seated or reclining on the ground, smoking or picking their teeth with twigs. But soldiers Joshua had seen earlier at Fort Prince George, the Cherokees, who came into the fort from the nearby Overhill Towns, were the people who truly fascinated him. The younger Cherokees, those Joshua's age and even several years older, were brown-skinned from head to toe and wore no clothing at all. The men wore breech cloths, some with tasseled sashes that hung down their thighs. Most also wore leggings and had chests decorated with intricate gunpowder tattoos impressed into their skin, symbolizing valor and wartime achievements. A few men wore moccasins, but most were barefoot. Several of the oldest men had ornaments of silver hanging from their earlobes, which had been stretched and cut ornamentally. The hair of the warriors was generally absent, except for one long braid at the crown of the scalp. This was greased heavily with bear oil. They pluck out the rest by the roots, Byron told Joshua when he asked, and they flinch not a bit, those sods. Pain means nothing to them. The Cherokee women, for the most part, had long braids of hair rolled into wreath-like piles atop their heads, held in place with silver brooches. Many wore colored ribbons or strips of cloth plaited into their hair or streaming from it past their shoulders. They wore knee-length skirts made of softened deerskin. A few wore short calico waistcoats, apparently obtained through British trade, and some wore nothing above the waist. The younger girls were entirely without clothing like the boys. At first, Joshua stared openly at the Indians' nakedness, for he was unaccustomed to it, until Hester scolded him in a whisper and made him ashamed. Many of the Cherokee women and older girls kept close company with soldiers, and Joshua soon realized, to the extent he was able to understand such things, that these had been taken by the soldiers as mates, or concubines. But there were also several white women and their children about, the recently arrived families of some of the soldiers. White and Indian mixed freely within the fort's boundaries. All in all, there was a spirit of unity between the Cherokees and the soldiers palpable enough even for young Joshua to detect. He went to his mother's side and into her ear whispered, I'm glad we've come here, Mother. Hester Byram smiled and patted his shoulder. As the red light of the fire soothed away the creases around Hester's eyes and mouth and erased the eternal dark circles beneath her eyes, Joshua thought that his mother was the most beautiful woman he had ever seen. Joshua and Hester spent the first night within the fort itself, sleeping on their blankets near a rocky promontory that jutted out of the ground between the parade ground and the officers' barracks near the north palisade. The scent of the dying bonfire lay heavily within the fort, mixing with the organic stench of the trench latrine, where Jack Byram was neither Hester nor Joshua knew. He had vanished earlier in the evening and had not returned for them. Be patient, Hester said. Your father is not a man to be rushed or told what to do. When he is ready, he will come for us. Joshua knew as well as his mother that Byram was probably passed out over a jug of rum somewhere. Drumbeats of reveille wakened Joshua the next morning. He rose, rolled up his blanket, and climbed atop the ledge from where he watched the colors raised over the Prince of Wales bastion on the northeastern corner of the irregularly shaped fortification. Afterward, he and his mother shared a silent breakfast of beef jerky and parched corn left over from the journey across the mountains and watched the soldiers drill on the parade ground. Joshua and Hester slowly explored the fort and surrounding grounds together for more than half of the day, staying out of the way of the red-coated regulars who drilled, practiced with bayonets, stood guard at the big gates of the fort, and did the other duties of military routine. But the soldiers accounted for only a portion of the bustling activity inside Fort Loudoun. Children played near the barracks west of the parade ground, and soldiers' wives sat in the shade of the various log and clapboard structures within the fort walls and talked as they sewed, turned, and in some cases nursed infants hidden beneath discreetly placed shawls. In early afternoon, Joshua left his mother in the company of a plump, talkative soldier's wife named Christiana Cox and left for further exploration on his own. The cannon were being placed atop high platforms at the fort's bastions. Joshua watched as one of the guns was rolled into place at the Duke of Cumberland bastion on the southwest corner and looked for his father among the mix of regulars, South Carolina provincials, civilians, and Cherokees watching the work. He did not see him, but did spot Captain DeMere, who in the morning light looked more haggard than he had the day before. Joshua would later learn that DeMere's health had declined under the strain of seeing the Fort Loudoun's completion, his only respite being that the cantankerous engineer DeBrom was long gone.
Despite his eccentricities, DeBrahm had designed a fort that was sound, if overly ornate. With Demir's more practical alterations, it was now an impressive fortification. Fort Loudon's walls consisted of an ample palisade of logs sharpened at the top and angled slightly outward over a sloping earthwork. Loopholes for muskets were drilled through the palisade at regular intervals. Such features were designed to make besieging the wall difficult and scaling it all but impossible. Even reaching the walls would be difficult. Outside the line of pales and beyond the earthwork was an encircling moat about 10 feet wide and 4 feet deep, filled with honey locusts that formed an impenetrable barrier. The moat was bridged to allow access to the fort's big gate. The soldiers' barracks stood along the west palisade. At the northwest facing King George Bastion was a powder magazine and nearby an area sufficiently large to graze livestock for food in time of siege. The much-used parade ground was a rectangular area in the center of the fort. The guardhouse stood near the east gate, between the Prince of Wales bastion and the blacksmith shop. Nearby was the well and garden area, and the fourth bastion, called the Queen Bastion. The blacksmith shop was bustling at the moment. Joshua approached it. A group of Cherokees had brought in 3 trade muskets for repairs. One of the Indians was arguing forcibly with someone. Joshua moved around to see more clearly and realized the Cherokee, who was a full head taller than his fellows, very scarred, and marked from long ago smallpox, was raging at none other than Jack Byram. The sight frightened Joshua. The Indian had a tomahawk on his hip. What if he became angry enough to use it? Joshua knew little of Indians, but had heard they were violent people. The Indian and Byram were arguing in a mix of English and Cherokee. Though he could not understand much of it, Joshua made out that the dispute was over one of the muskets, which the Indian apparently claimed was defective. Byram, obviously the traitor who had sold the gun in the first place, was just as vigorously alleging that any problem was the result of carelessness or abuse by the warrior himself, whom Byram referred to as Bloody Eagle. The fort blacksmith stood close by, listening to the argument with a growing look of alarm. At last, he stepped forward, pulled Byram aside, and spoke to him out of earshot of the Indians. Joshua, however, was close enough to hear what was said.
Byram, you keep your head. If Bloody Eagle takes a dislike to you, he'll make you suffer for it, and the rest of us besides, no doubt. Tell him you're his friend, that you respect him, and that I'll see his musket repaired at your expense, or I'll wrap my arm around your head. Do you understand me?
Byram snorted and grew red.
I'll not pay to repair the musket of that wretch's side. Go to Satan's blazes of both of you.
With that, he turned on his heel and walked away, almost knocking Joshua over in the process, yet not even noticing him. A strong rum smell trailed after Byram. The blacksmith returned to Bloody Eagle, who stood very straight, arms crossed over his chest, looking down a long, crooked nose at the smith.
You're as powerful in persuasion as you are in war, Awahili, the blacksmith said. The gun shall be repaired as you wish. I am proud to repair the musket of the great Bloody Eagle. A gift from me to you.
The warrior's expression never changed, but Joshua read satisfaction in the dark, narrow eyes. Bloody Eagle and the other Cherokees turned and walked away with great dignity. The smith watched them go, shook his head, and turned to Joshua, who had come near.
If ever there's one to be careful about, it's a Bloody Eagle, he said. He'd be glad to hang the scalp of any of us eunuchers from his pole any day. And I'll not lose my hair because Jack Byram is so rummy a fool. I plan to keep my thatch. How about you, young gentleman?
Yes, sir. Joshua wheeled and took off at a trot after Byram, who was walking with an uneven, drunken gait across the parade yard. At that moment, a loud boom echoed across the stockade from the direction of the King George Bastion. As the blast echoed away, Joshua heard a babble of voices, some sending up distinctly British cheers, others Cherokee war cries. The first of the cannon Jack Byram had brought across the mountains had been tested, and the results, it seemed, had been pleasing. Joshua smiled, but then looked at his father and was shocked. Jack Byram had fallen to his knees in the middle of the parade ground, his hands flat on the top of his head. Joshua's smile faded. He ran forward.
Father, what's wrong?
Byram, startled by his son, looked up sharply. Suddenly, he seemed embarrassed.
Nothing's wrong, boy, he said. It's just for a second when them Cherokees yelled as clear as day, I could see that Bloody Eagle coming up behind me and...
He didn't finish, but shuddered and rose.
Where's your mother, he asked. It's time I took you home.
Joshua was crestfallen.
Home?
back to Charlestown?
Byram cast up his eyes. Don't be a fool, boy. Your home ain't Charlestown no more. It's Tuskegee. You're going to live among the Indians, boy. You like that notion, eh?
Yes, Joshua said. I like that.
But Byram hadn't waited to hear the answer. He had seen Hester cross the stockade yard, still talking to Christiana Cox, and had already headed toward her. Joshua followed. For the next month, Joshua Byram's life was a blur or a change. Greater even than he had imagined was the transition from South Carolina yard child to Overhill Cherokee trader's assistant, which was, in effect, what he became. His usefulness to his father was limited at best, but what jobs he could handle, cleaning trade muskets, folding hides, polishing hatchets, stacking boxes and kegs, he did with enthusiasm at the little complex of three log huts that composed Jack Byram's trading center in the little town of Tuskegee, close by Fort Loudoun. Hester, Joshua was pleased to see, adapted to her new life more readily than he had thought she would. Though his sensitivities were limited by his age, Joshua nevertheless was a good reader of his mother's mind and heart. When she was happy or when she hurt, he sensed it. Such sensitivities Joshua certainly had not inherited from his father. Jack Byram went through life virtually oblivious to his wife's feelings and needs. To him, she was handy for preparing a good meal, warming his bed on cold nights, fulfilling his physical desires. Only one thing seemed to make him aware of his wife as a woman worthy of attention and protection, and that was the increasingly obvious efforts of Henry Dory to steal her from him. Dory, whose trade store was in Tiquilitzi, Bloody Eagle's village, was not particularly focused on his amorous endeavors. He already had on his string at least two Cherokee women, one expatriated Creek girl and the wife of one of the provincial soldiers, but he seemed particularly determined to steal Hester away from Byram. Byram at first ignored Dory's lechery, for he had seen the man striving just as hard to woo the plump and religious Christiana Cox from her red-haired soldier husband. But after a time and several warnings that Dory ignored, Byram lost his patience. Though not prone to give much affection of his own to his wife, he was even less prone to let somebody else try to fill the gap. Joshua watched the growing conflict from the perspective of a child, but as he usually did, understood far more than the adults around him suspected. On August 18th, 1757, the day before Captain Raymond de Mare was to turn over command of Fort Loudoun to his newly arrived brother, Captain Paul de Mare, and leave the wilderness for reasons of health, the conflict between Byram and Dory came to blows, then to blades. Dory was left bleeding on the ground beside Byram's store, a shallow but painful gash across his chest. Soldiers came at the behest of the Cherokees and hauled both victim and wounder to Fort Loudoun, where they were detained in the guardhouse until morning. Joshua managed to slip inside the fort in the confusion and spent the night on the soft ground at the edge of one of the gardens near the southern palisades. Chapter 2. Morning light streaming into Fort Loudoun found Joshua Byram already awake. He thought briefly of his mother and wondered if she was worried by his absence from their cabin in Tuskegee, then put aside the concern, knowing that by now she surely was accustomed to his wandering ways. A natural-born son of the frontier, Joshua had even at his age spent nights away from home, sleeping at the houses of Cherokee friends or even in the forests around Tuskegee. Standing and shaking the sleep from his brain, Joshua brushed off his clothing. A commotion at the gate drew his attention. When the guards threw open the gate, Joshua's eyes widened as a small but notable Indian processional entered. At its head was an Indian man of remarkably small stature and thin frame. At first glance, Joshua could almost have taken him for a boy, but that would have been a judgment from size alone, for the man's face, even from this distance, gave a clear impression of age. Joshua guessed him to be of middle age or older. Glinting in the morning sunlight were beaded silver ornaments hanging from the cut lobes of his ears, and on his cheeks were large scars of the sort worn by Cherokees of distinction. Accompanying him was a small group of warriors, seemingly serving as bodyguards and escorts. Joshua knew immediately that he was seeing the famous Cherokee leader and diplomat, Atakulakula, called Little Carpenter because of his craftsmanlike skill in piecing together treaties and diplomatic accords. Joshua was impressed to be seeing such a celebrated Indian. He had heard that Little Carpenter, in the days when he was still a young man, had journeyed all the way to London,
and been given an audience with King George II in Windsor Castle. Little Carpenter had the respect of both the Cherokees and the British. He was probably the most famous and influential of the Overhill leaders at present, his power rivaling that even of the Emperor Old Hop, his uncle, and it was largely through his diplomatic efforts that Fort Loudoun had come to be built. Likely, Little Carpenter was at the fort today to greet the new commander. Joshua watched as Little Carpenter and his delegation were welcomed by Raymond de Mare outside the officers' quarters, then ushered inside. Joshua's thoughts turned to his father, and the somnolent morning atmosphere hanging like a haze over the fort. Joshua quietly crossed over to the guardhouse in hopes of seeing Byram. No one stopped him. The sentries were busy at the gate, bringing in the big guard dogs that were put outside the walls each night. "Whoa there, Joshua! Where goes my young friend?" The voice was familiar and came from behind. Joshua wheeled and faced Nathan Cox, husband of his mother's friend Christiana. Cox's hair was almost as red as his coat. "Where you going, son?" Cox looked him up and down. "From the look of you, I'd guess you spent the night in damp ground." "I did, over yonder. I came in when they brought in father." Cox looked serious. "Aye, I heard about what happened. Sorry thing to occur in the captain's last hours here. What will happen to father?" Cox shook his head. "That I don't know. But if I had my guesses, it's more likely that the worst of it will go to Dory. I won't be false with you, Joshua. There are plenty enough complaints received here from the Indians about both Henry Dory and Jack Byron. Bloody Eagle in particular seems to dislike your father, but Dory is the worst by far, and Captain de Mare knows that. Likely this will result in Dory leaving our midst, and for that we can all be glad." "I want to speak with father." Cox shook his head. "That will not be possible. You'll see him later, I'm sure. Now be off with you. We've got important visitors in the fort this morning." "Little Carpenter?" "Indeed. Coming laden with white beads to give the new Captain de Mare. For my part, I hate to see the old Captain de Mare go. He's a fine officer, and knows how to deal with the Cherokees. If the new one does not, we'll all feel the results. You repeat none of this, by the way." Joshua looked toward the officers' quarters. "I wish I could meet Little Carpenter." Nathan Cox laughed. "Perhaps you shall before all is done. Now be gone before someone skins you for poking about where you don't belong." As it turned out, Joshua did meet Little Carpenter shortly after noon that day. With his father in the stockade, there was no work to be done, so Joshua went down to the river to skip stones across the water, aiming the missiles at floating sticks that he pretended were French vessels. So wrapped up in his game he became that he did not hear the approach of a man behind him. Turning to search for a new flat stone, he saw the figure all at once, yelled in surprise, and staggered back into the water where he fell into a pool in the midst of a jumble of eroded boulders. Joshua thrashed and kicked, then thrashed back to the bank. The man who had startled him walked down and extended his hand. Joshua was awed to realize it was Little Carpenter himself. The bumps that rose on his skin were not entirely caused by the cold water. Little Carpenter spoke in the dialect of the Overhill Cherokees, among whom he had spent his life. "Come up, young friend. You need not fear me." Joshua, once out of the water, stood staring at the Cherokee leader, who apparently had wandered down to the river alone. Though the day was hot, the boy shivered as the wind wrapped itself round him. "I am Atakulakula," the Indian said. "I am sorry I frightened you." "I am Joshua Byram," Joshua responded haltingly, for he was still learning the Cherokee language. "I was not frightened. I just wanted to swim." Little Carpenter did not laugh aloud, but his dark eyes sparkled with mirth. "Then I hope your swim was pleasant. Good day to you, swimmer." When Little Carpenter was gone, Joshua ran back to Tuskegee and into his father's cabin, wanting to tell Hester what had just happened. He was startled to find Jack Byram already there and stopped on his heels. "You're wet, boy. I fell in the river." Byram laughed. He seemed unusually happy. "Fell in the river. That's about what I'd expect of you." He returned his attention to Hester. "I think they'd been looking for a reason to send Dory on his way in any case," he said. "There's not a soul about red or white who likes him. He won't worry me or you or nobody else anymore." "Is everything all right again?" Joshua asked. "Aye, it is, boy," Byram said. He went to the back of the cabin and picked up a crockery jug. Pulling the stopper, he took a long swallow of rum, wiped his mouth with the back of his hand.
"I met Little Carpenter," Joshua said.
"That's good, dear," Hester responded in a distracted tone. Byram said nothing. He was busy with another celebratory mouthful of rum.
and he called me Ayonini, Joshua continued.
Good name for a boy who falls into rivers, Byram said. Joshua left the cabin to let the sun finish drying his clothes. Byram took a third swallow of rum, closed the jug, and sat it on the table. He laughed aloud. Good riddance to Henry Dory, and may he go to damnation, he said as he closed the cabin door. In the darkened cabin, he wiped his mouth once more, gave his wife a look that filled her with a familiar dread, and came toward her. Captain Raymond DeMere left Fort Loudon that same day, leaving the command in the hands of his brother. Raymond DeMere would never return to the fort, and though he did not yet know it, neither would he see his brother again, for grim changes were in the wind, both for Fort Loudon and for the British and Cherokees in general. Henry Dory also left the Overhill Towns as ordered. Byram's business increased thereafter, but so did his abuses of his trade. As months passed, Joshua sensed a growing coolness on the part of the Cherokees who dealt with his father. That concerned him, but not nearly as much as the increasing sadness he sensed in his mother. Hester kept more to herself these days and cried often. Joshua caught her in tears several times, but when he asked her what was wrong, she would not answer him beyond saying she missed her home at Charlestown. Joshua remembered her prediction that she would never return home if she crossed the mountains and felt a great dread he could not shake off. Joshua saw little Carpenter many times over the next 3 years. The chief visited the fort frequently, conferring with Captain Paul DeMere, who proved to be a more ineffective dealer with the Cherokees than his brother before him. Paul DeMere, the troops grumbled privately, antagonized the Cherokees with patronizations and disrespect. The level of unhappiness at the fort grew, and as time passed, a sense of tension began to develop between the Overhill Cherokees and the approximately 300 British colonials in and about Fort Loudon. Joshua remained friendly with the Cherokees, despite their growing dislike for his father and his exorbitant credit rates and weighted trade scales. Still, Byram's business flourished, and in his store he kept a ready stock of cloth, match coats, powder, balls, knives, rum, blankets, axes, paints, and jewelry. The trade muskets that he sold, shotguns of high caliber, low price, about 10 shillings, and poor workmanship kept the Fort Loudon blacksmith continually busy making repairs for the Cherokees who openly fretted about the low quality of goods Byram sold them. Byron's most vocal critic was Bloody Eagle from the village of Tikwalitsi. On several occasions, Joshua saw the pox-scarred warrior who sometimes brought to the fort his nephew of about Joshua's age. Joshua stayed clear of Bloody Eagle, for he had heard the Indian was cruel and evil and ate the roasted livers of white boys. Joshua didn't really believe the latter, but saw no reason to take chances. Besides, Bloody Eagle obviously knew that Joshua was Byram's son and disliked him for it. Twice, before Joshua had started keeping his distance, Bloody Eagle had abruptly jumped toward Joshua, growling, "Byram," and laughed as Joshua scrambled away. Byram made occasional trips back to Charlestown for resupply, but never took Joshua or Hester with him, though Hester often pleaded to go. Byram's indifference to Hester angered Joshua, but there was nothing he could do to counter it. He sadly watched his mother's spirits steadily darken. The only things that seemed to brighten them were Joshua himself, the friendship of some of the Cherokee women, and the gentle and ever-talkative Christiana Cox. The fort itself expanded under Paul DeMere's command. By the end of 1757, he had constructed 2 corn houses within the fort, along with a permanent double-chimneyed guardroom. Early in 1758, he had constructed a house for himself and was talking of building a large observation tower of a sort the engineer DeBrom had proposed but never constructed. Life at the fort was, for the soldiers, usually a drudgery. The barracks were wet when it rained, hot in the dry midsummer, and bitter cold in the winter. The trench latrine in the fort stank terribly and kept the enclosure swarming with flies during warm weather. Pay was low, and unless the Cherokees helped out through barter and trade, the soldiers faced continual low supplies of food and other goods. Corn was raised at the fort, but most of the vegetables came from the Cherokee fields. Livestock was also raised in and about the fort, and the 2 butchers stationed there were kept continually at work. The vast piles of bones and offal they produced combined a sickly, sweet, rotten smell with the musky stench of the latrines. Nathan Cox complained constantly about the conditions and his fear of the Cherokees, who he believed disliked him for some reason and wished him harm. Captain John Stewart, according to Cox, was a particular favorite of Little Carpenter and had proven himself the best diplomat in the fort. Through his contact with the Cherokees, the supply problems were controlled, if not overcome. Meanwhile, Stewart, DeMayer, and other officers continued in their efforts to keep the Cherokees allied with Britain against the French, and many times from Byram's store, Joshua heard the boom of the fort's cannon heralding war parties coming home with French scalps and the occasional severed French head swinging from poles. On the surface, the British-Cherokee alliance appeared strong. Little Carpenter himself kept busy on behalf of the British cause. In September 1757, he left Fort Loudoun, the cannon firing in his honor, and went out with a war party to battle the French. He and his men killed several French soldiers near Fort de l'Assomption, at the confluence of the Tennessee and Ohio rivers, took prisoners, and came home victorious in January 1758. In the spring of that year, Little Carpenter was given the honor of traveling to Charlestown to report personally on his military successes. When Hester heard of it, she told her son, "Even a heathen chief is privileged to do that which I am kept from," and closed herself up in the house to brood. When Little Carpenter returned the next January, telling of his reception in Carolina, even Jack Byram was impressed. Upon arrival in Charlestown, the chief had been met by two companies of the Highland Regiment, greeted at the town hall by a company of salute-firing grenadiers, and then taken to meet with Governor William Henry Littleton. It was treatment worthy of royalty, and Little Carpenter relished the gifts and attention. But as usual, the English colonials wanted a gift of their own, in this case a pledge. And Little Carpenter gave it, though with some reluctance, to both South Carolina's Littleton and Virginia's Colonel William Byrd. The Overhill Cherokees, Little Carpenter agreed, would provide direct aid to Virginia's war efforts, even though Little Carpenter had long been displeased with Cherokee relations with Virginia. He had sufficient cause for displeasure. As early as 1756, some Cherokees already in the service of that colony had been killed and their scalps presented fraudulently as those of French-supporting Indians for the sake of the bounty upon such, creating a crisis in British-Indian relations. Further, Virginia had always been slow or unwilling to respond to requests from the Cherokees. For example, sometime before Fort Loudoun was built, Virginia had placed a fort in the Overhill country, then neglected to garrison it. Little Carpenter was good to his word, and by June of 1758, a large war party was ready to leave Chota to help the Virginians. Then came a delay that infuriated the British. A Cherokee conjurer detected signs that war efforts for Virginia would be met with death and illness if undertaken immediately. The mission was therefore delayed by decision of the Cherokee Council, for warriors could by no means take on an effort doomed from the beginning. Though the British were furious at the delay, partly because gifts and ammunition had already been given to the warriors, the Indians would not be swayed. Byram laughed about the officer's plight over his supper table and derided both the superstitious Indians and the chagrined British military leaders. The following month, Little Carpenter abruptly announced the delay was over. He now would lead warriors on Virginia's behalf, as promised. He and a contingent of 60 Cherokee and Catawba warriors joined General John Forbes as he prepared to march against a northern French outpost to Fort Duquesne. Word trickled back to Fort Loudoun of the troubles that beset Little Carpenter. Forbes had taken an immediate dislike to the Indian, who demanded many presents from Forbes' already dwindling store of supplies. Forbes considered Little Carpenter a rascal and complained of his stupid speeches. Nevertheless, he gave in to Little Carpenter's demands, though from then on he treated the Indians poorly. A dispatch from Virginia's Governor Dinwiddie was to interrupt Little Carpenter's war plans yet again and forewarn the coming troubles that would disrupt the lives of the people of Fort Loudoun. Strife had again arisen between Virginia frontiersmen and Cherokees. Little Carpenter was needed to negotiate peace. The chief left to answer Dinwiddie's call, despite Forbes' efforts to keep him from it, and Forbes labeled Little Carpenter a deserter. The chief's small party was intercepted and disarmed. Shortly thereafter, Forbes took Fort Duquesne with unexpected ease, for the French had abandoned it. Little Carpenter defended his desertion by telling Governor Littleton that he had learned in advance from the Shawnees that the French were going to abandon the fort and thus his services would be unnecessary in any case. He had tried to pass that word on to Forbes, he said, but Forbes just would not listen. Word of these events, though slow to arrive, generated great interest at Fort Loudoun, where life had gone on much as usual despite the atmosphere of growing tension between the Cherokees and British. In 1758, the fort was visited by two Presbyterian preachers, the Reverend John Martin, who preached to the Indians with little success, and later the Reverend William Richardson, a younger man who remained until February 1759. Richardson was at the fort when the cold of winter had settled over the land, and in the Cherokee towns beside the frozen river he found Old Hop, Standing Turkey, and other Cherokee leaders cordial and yet tense as they talked of the great man above. Since Joshua had heard none of Martin's talks, Richardson's were the first authentic sermons he had ever heard, and he was impressed by the young preacher's lofty words, spoken in the soft accent of his native Whitehaven, England. Particularly fascinated was Joshua to witness the baptism of two children in the fort. Hester tried to have Joshua baptized as well, but Jack Byram would not hear of it. As 1759 progressed, Christiana Cox gave to Joshua a gift that would serve him the rest of his days. Using as her only resources a battered Bible and a stick with which she scratched letters and words in the sand, she taught Joshua to read. Not well, but enough to serve him. It was a skill neither his father nor mother possessed, and though Hester was proud of Joshua's literacy and even tried to learn the rudiments of reading herself, Jack Byram was bitter about it. "It's no good when a young bugger begins to see himself better than them what raised him," he complained. But Joshua paid little heed to his father. As he grew older, he was steadily building and strengthening an invisible wall between himself and Jack Byram, as impenetrable as the moat-circled palisades of Fort Loudoun. The beginning of the end of Fort Loudoun happened far from its own grounds, along the Catawba and Yadkin Rivers in North Carolina. A band of Cherokees killed 15 settlers in retaliation for the slaying of other Cherokees in Virginia. The North Carolina slayings were too much for the colonial authorities, and the call went out to Overhill Cherokees to turn over the guilty Indians. Meanwhile, Little Carpenter went off in 1759 for further fighting against the French in the Illinois country. This, despite Paul DeMere's request that he remain in the towns of the Overhills to soothe growing local tensions. Old Hop and other prominent Overhill Cherokees were starting to favor a shifting of allegiances to France. It was rumored that Old Hop had visited with French emissaries in Chota itself. The Cherokees' law left it up to the kinsmen of those Indians guilty of the North Carolina slaying to decide whether they would heed the demand to turn them over, and the answer was a firm, frustrating no. "There'll be blood to come of this, just you wait," Jack Byram predicted to his family. "The time may arrive when we'll find out firsthand whether Fort Loudoun is strong enough to protect us." Joshua, with 3 years maturing and living among the Cherokees behind him, understood the precariousness of the situation. And on the afternoon that an ashen-faced Jack Byram came into the cabin with news that Littleton had embargoed all ammunition for to the Cherokees, he saw at once that matters would certainly worsen. A main complaint of the Cherokees had long been a lack of ammunition, and with their supply completely cut off, they had no good way to maintain the deerskin trade that had become vital to them, to kill game for their own tables with the efficiency to which they had become accustomed, or to defend themselves from enemies. The embargo would only heighten Cherokee resentment of the British, turn the Indians toward the French as an ammunition source, and make raids against border settlements more likely. By September, the situation had degenerated to the point that many traders fled back over the mountains into South Carolina. Hester pleaded with her husband to do the same, but he refused. "We'll take to the fort," he said. "Maybe this will be a storm that blows over." It did not, and a series of unfortunate occurrences only stirred it to greater fury. Cherokee war chief Oconostota, along with several other Indians, including Bloody Eagle, traveled to Charlestown to seek an end to the ammunition embargo. When they arrived, they found Littleton already set in a posture of war, and the entire Cherokee delegation was taken hostage. Word was sent back to the Overhill towns that the prisoners would be held until the Indians guilty of the fatal border raids were turned over to the British authorities. In October, a force of 70 provincials arrived at Fort Loudoun bearing supplies of food and ammunition. A good supply of salted meat was already in the fort, for the influential Cherokee Ostinaco had attempted to steal the Fort Loudoun cattle herd in September. DeMere had responded by having the herd driven inside the fort for slaughter, butchering, and salting. Joshua, like everyone else, was offended by the stenches of the butchering, but he noticed that his mother was made outright sick by it. He asked Christiana Cox about it, and a smile both happy and sad spread the woman's broad face.
Don't you know, Joshua, that's always the way of a woman with a little one in her belly. Your mother is bearing a child, just as I am.
Joshua's eyes widened in surprise. He had not suspected his mother's pregnancy and certainly had not realized Christiana was also with child. The latter had always been plump in any case, and pregnancy made little difference in her shape. Hope continued for a peaceful resolution of the Cherokee problem. But in the meantime, living conditions for the fort's inhabitants were crowded and unsanitary. The Byrams were forced to make their home in a tent pitched near the soldiers' barracks. All the usual stenches and deprivations of fort life doubled, then tripled. Hester Byram became chronically depressed and seemed to age a decade within a month.
In December, Littleton himself, with his hostages in tow, arrived at Fort Prince George on the first leg of a planned military campaign against the Cherokees.
Little Carpenter, meanwhile, came home from war and found Old Hop openly favoring an alliance with France. When he learned of Littleton's hostages, Little Carpenter traveled to Fort Prince George under a British flag and there negotiated the release of Okanastota and Bloody Eagle. Eventually, Littleton returned to Charlestown, leaving the remaining hostages at Fort Prince George. In the Cherokee towns, the situation was volatile. Emperor Old Hop died suddenly, and Standing Turkey came to power in his place. Okonostota and Bloody Eagle, meanwhile, stirred war spirit against the British. The year 1759 ended with a bleak situation on the frontier. And in February 1760, 2 months before Joshua Byram's 10th birthday, an event occurred that erased almost all hope of peace. Okanastota and Bloody Eagle traveled to Fort Prince George, ostensibly to talk to its commander about a diplomatic mission to Charlestown. The commander, believing the Indians to be sincere, left the fort to meet with them and fell, mortally wounded, when more than a score of hidden Indian gunmen opened fire upon Okanastota's signal. Inside the fort, the enraged soldiers descended upon the 23 Cherokee hostages and killed them. Little Carpenter, near Fort Prince George at the time, was appalled by all that had occurred, returned to the Overhill towns, gathered his family, and moved into the forest to live alone as a gesture of non-involvement. With the slaying of the hostages, the fate of Fort Loudoun was sure. In March, the Cherokees began firing on the crowded fort. For 4 days, Joshua and Hester huddled together, listening to the relentless hammering of the Indian guns. "Don't worry, Mother. Father's cannon will keep them out," Joshua said. And so they did. Because of the great guns, the Indians could not get close enough to fire effectively on the fort. At length, the gunfire subsided, the Cherokees grown weary of wasting their precious ammunition. Hester ventured the hope that the siege was ending, but a grim Jack Byram shook his head. "Not ending," he said, "but just beginning. The damn red devils are going to starve us out, and once they get us outside them walls, it'll be a worse hell than any preacher ever dreamed up." Nathan Cox, who was sharing a meal with the Byrams when the comment was made, looked up, his face grown white.
"Torture?"
he asked.
"Aye, and for you soldiers, the worst of it, no doubt."
Cox was silent for half a minute, thinking.
"What will come of this siege, Jack? Is there hope for us?"
The trader shrugged and lit his pipe.
"If I were a soldier, I'd head for the forest," he said. "I'd never let them get their bloody hands on me."
Cox put down his fork and ate nothing else the rest of the meal. That night, Hester Byram held Joshua to her so tightly he could barely breathe and talked fondly of Charlestown as she patted her swelling belly. Meanwhile, on a cot hidden behind a curtain in the soldiers' barracks, Christiana Cox gave birth to a baby girl whom she named Beth. In the days that followed, Joshua noticed the paradox of time common to prisoners. Days passing as slowly as weeks, weeks passing as rapidly as days. Demir tried to keep the fort's routine and daily life as close to normal as possible, but the strain showed on every face and in the never-ending parade ground military exercises, which now seemed travesties to the people forced to watch them. In May, Demir finally was able to give news that brought cheer. Colonel Archibald Montgomery was marching toward Fort Prince George with an army of 1,300 regular and 350 provincial troops, their purpose, the relief of Fort Loudoun. For the first time in days, Joshua was surrounded by smiles,
Hester seemed younger, reminding him of the way she had been before Jack Byram brought them over the mountains. Joshua had had much time to observe the sort of siege to which Fort Loudon was being subjected and found it a peculiar one in several ways. Though the fort was supposed to be cut off by the besieging Cherokees, it nevertheless had abundant visitors, chief among them, Little Carpenter, who came almost daily. Other Cherokees came as well, including the Cherokee mates of Fort Loudon soldiers. Many foodstuffs, even a few live hogs and game birds, were smuggled into the fort by then, though not in quantities great enough to staunch the diminishing of supply levels. In mid-May, Demir announced that rations would be cut to one daily quart of corn per person. On May 25th, the fort's gates opened to two South Carolina traders who brought in several horse loads of relief supplies that they had obtained through trade with sympathetic Cherokees. Demir conferred with them, and by the way, Nathan Cox, the Byram family, heard their story. Lieutenant Governor William Bull of South Carolina, now exercising power in the absence of Littleton, who had been named governor of Jamaica, had sent the traders with loads of ribbons and paint to barter for supplies for the fort. Along the way, though, the traders had been raided by white bandits in the mountains and had lost three pack horse loads of the goods. The identity of the bandits was unknown, but it was suspected they were traders who hoped to use the stolen goods for their own profit. Arrival of the goods cheered the fort's haggard residents, but not enough was received to make a substantial difference in the worsening situation. In early June, Little Carpenter informed Demir that his own status among the Cherokees was declining because of his pro-British stand.
"My brothers hide everything from me and call me the friend of the whites," he said. "Only Tomatli Town wishes peace. The rest want war."
After June 5th, Little Carpenter came no more to Fort Loudon, nor did any more Cherokee women come bearing food. Little Carpenter was expelled from the Cherokee Council and once again took to the woods with his family to live alone. Then, in mid-month, word came that threw the fort's inhabitants into their greatest despair yet. The relief force under Montgomery had been attacked in a mountain pass near the town of Itshaw. Though only 25 of the huge force were killed and 70 wounded, Montgomery had declared a retreat. Though he had ravaged several Cherokee towns, he would not be coming to the aid of Fort Loudon after all. On July 7th, the Fort Loudon occupants consumed the last of their bread. Rations were cut to 4 ounces of horse meat a day, plus a handful of beans and plums. By August 1st, there were left only 8 thin horses to use for meat, and Demare in despair declared the fort abandoned and forsaken by God and man. On the night of August 4th, several of Fort Loudon soldiers deserted into the surrounding woods. Christiana Cox, brave woman that she was, did not publicly shed even a tear when she learned that her husband was among them. Nathan Cox, overwhelmed at the prospect of Indian torture, had left his family abandoned in a fort on the verge of collapse. On the night of August 5th, Jack Byram shook Joshua awake. Byram's breath stank of rum, for he had been drinking from a flask he had secreted since entering the fort.
"Go get help, boy," he said. "Your mother's about to birth a baby."
Chapter 3. Joshua wiped the linen cloth across his mother's brow again, and there were faint stains of red on it when it came away. In her strain, she was bursting tiny vessels beneath the surface of her skin, mixing her sweat with blood. The sight of it terrified Joshua. Hester was fighting with stubborn determination to give birth to a child equally determined not to be born. That childbirth was painful, Joshua had known. Just how wrenchingly painful he had not realized until now. "It's going to be well, Mother," he said, trying to comfort himself as much as her. "The baby is coming, and when it's done, you will be well." If Hester heard his reassurances, she did not give evidence of it. Her pain was obviously building again, swelling to an even higher peak. She threw back her head, closed her eyes, and bit her lip until it bled, barely restraining a scream. Tears came to Joshua's eyes, and he looked at Christiana Cox imploringly. In the corner of the tent, Jack Byram drained the last of his rum and turned away. He ducked out through the flap door, having seen all he wanted to see. Now he wanted to get as far away as he could, smoke his pipe, and try to forget what was happening. Joshua saw his father leave and hated him for it. Again, he swiped the cloth across his mother's brow. Her pain was partially subsiding once more, but Joshua knew that in a few moments another agonizing cramp, worse than before, would seize her. "If only she wasn't so weakened," Christiana said. "So little food she's had, and poor at that.
A woman needs her strength for such a time as this, and poor Hester's got none left.
Joshua could barely make himself ask the inescapable question.
Will she die?
Christiana gave him a reprimanding look.
Hush, boy. Don't let that thought free in this place. Keep your fears to yourself and send your prayers to God. Now brace yourself. Here comes another thrust, and perhaps this time she will...
Hester could not hold back the scream this time. She cried out in agony and gripped Joshua's wrist so tightly that his hand grew red and he feared she would snap his bones like brittle sticks. Christiana's eyes grew larger and she began to urge Hester on.
That's right, Hester. Push it out. You're doing it, dear. Just keep on. Keep on.
Hester tried hard, but her strength broke. She closed her eyes and became limp. Joshua was truly scared now. He leaned close to his mother's ashen face.
It's all right, Joshua, Christiana said. Let her rest. The next time, it will come.
But she won't be able to survive another one, Joshua said.
I can tell she won't.
Be quiet, boy. What do you know of women? God never made stronger creatures. Hark, now we begin again.
Joshua did not watch this time. He closed his eyes tight and prayed as best he knew how. Christiana made noises of encouragement, then fear, and then delight. With his eyes still closed, Joshua heard the slap of a hand on wet flesh, then the weak but fresh cry of an infant. He opened his eyes and gazed in awe at a tiny clay-colored boy that Christiana held in her hands. He had never seen a child that looked so small and feeble. Yet the baby was crying lustily, its eyes wet wrinkles in a gray face, its mouth wide open and toothless.
His color, all is as it should be. As he cries, he will fill his lungs with good air and turn pink as a rose. This is a miracle you are seeing, Joshua. Look, even now he's searching for a good breast to feed him. It's a small but strong brother you have, Joshua Byram.
Joshua wiped away his tears, smiled, and took his mother's hand.
Mother, look what you've done.
Christiana held the baby close to warm it, then wrapped it in its receiving cloth and prepared to give it to its mother. She had not noticed the abruptness with which Joshua had cut off his words.
Hester, your boy is ready to...
When Christiana looked up, Joshua's eyes were wet again, his lip trembling. His right hand lay across his mother's brow, and his left gripped a waxen hand that was much too limp. Hester's bosom was not rising and falling with breath, and her eyes were half opened and fixed, staring up into the peak of the tent.
Oh, Joshua,
Christiana whispered. Joshua's voice was quavering yet sounded fierce as he spat out his words.
It's his fault. He killed her. Joshua, you must not blame this child. He did not bring himself into being, not the baby. My father. Mother said she would die if she came across the mountains, but he made her come. She never had a choice, and now she's dead because of him.
Christiana said nothing. She drew the baby to her, then quietly lowered one side of her dress and let it begin to nurse.
It's up to Jack Byram to name him, I suppose, she said.
No, Joshua responded.
I will give him a name.
Christiana looked at him questioningly.
Your father will allow that? Why should he care? He has never cared about anything or anyone else but himself.
Joshua went to the baby, reached out and touched its narrow shoulders under the swaddling receiving cloth.
His name will be Samuel, he said. Is that a special name?
Joshua said,
it's the name I would have chosen for myself.
Christiana smiled down at the baby, who was almost choking in a milk flow too heavy for a newborn.
Samuel Byram, Christiana said. It is a good name indeed.
No.
Not Byram,
Joshua said forcefully.
Christiana was confused. I don't understand. His name, Joshua said, will be Samuel Cox. My father is not fit to raise him. He's yours, if you'll have him.
Christiana did not answer with words, but her smile of assent spoke just as clearly. She hugged the baby closer. Joshua looked into Hester's pale face, closed her eyes with his fingers, kissed her clammy, cooling cheek.
and finally drew up the blanket until she was completely covered. After that, he looked at her and touched her no more. Little Samuel, in a way, proved to be the salvation of both Joshua and Christiana. By smothering the baby with as much love as she gave her own natural child, Christiana soothed her hidden grief over the desertion of her husband. And Joshua devoted himself to the safety and welfare of his brother in a fierce determination not to see Hester's fatal childbirthing efforts come to naught. As for Jack Byram, his disinterest was as great as Joshua had predicted. Byram expressed no concern for his new offspring or any visible grief over the death of his wife. He acted as if nothing mattered any longer, as if fate had some grim, inescapable doom awaiting him. He moved about in a way that reminded Joshua of Nathan Cox's manner before his desertion and often talked fearfully of Bloody Eagle, as if the warrior were lying in wait for him just beyond the fort's palisades. Hester was buried with a minimum of ceremony near the King George Bastion. Her grave was marked with wood rather than stone, for permanence did not seem to matter. The unspoken belief of all the fort's people now was that Fort Loudon and all in it would soon not exist. The Cherokees would destroy it as soon as Paul DeMere accepted the inevitable and opted for surrender. The troop desertions had diminished not only the fort's manpower, but also drained the last remnants of the will to resist by those remaining. Even as Hester Byram was buried, negotiations with the Cherokees were beginning. Captain John Stewart, rather than DeMere, represented the British in the negotiations, for he was as popular with the Cherokees as Paul DeMere was unpopular. Joshua saw DeMere from time to time on those last days. He looked wasted and pale, and moved in the same kind of cloud of doom that Jack Byram did. Joshua found himself drawn away from DeMere when he passed, for the man was like an incarnation of defeat and death. On Friday, August 8th, Fort Loudon's remaining troops staged a final parade on the grounds. The civilians and soldiers' dependents stood about, watching in silence as the British colors were lowered. That night, Fort Loudon's people spent in silent musing over what was to come after they passed out of the stockade. Joshua slept little. He stayed close by Christiana and Samuel, urging himself to remain brave no matter what. But he could not feel brave. Even though Stewart had announced that the surrender terms included freedom for Fort Loudon's people, an escorted march to Virginia or South Carolina, and the right to keep such arms as were needed for the journey, Joshua could not convince himself the ordeal really was over. More than anything, he feared for what would happen to Samuel, whose survival had become the most important thing in his life. The next morning, the remaining 180 men and 70 women and children of Fort Loudon passed through the gates for the last time, crossing the log bridge spanning Gerald de Brom's locust-filled moat. At the head of the march were DeMere and Stewart, the former deliberately erect and soldierly, the latter more relaxed but grim of expression. When Joshua passed through the gate, he turned and looked lingeringly behind him, for his mother was still inside, her body buried in soil upon which she had never wanted to tread. To Joshua, that irony seemed the most tragic and cruel part of this entire ordeal. Announcement came back through the lines that the group would be marched to Fort Prince George. That heartened Joshua somewhat, for he liked the idea of returning to South Carolina, but he also dreaded the prospect of passing through the treacherous mountains. He remembered the traders who had recently come and their talk of bandits. Would such lie in wait to raid the enfeebled refugees in some mountain pass? He feared for Samuel. The day dragged on. The people trudged ceaselessly. Every mile seemed like 3, and to Joshua there was no beauty or joy in the land any longer. Even the sense of unconfinement, so noticeable to people long penned up, counted for little. The Cherokees who escorted the refugees wore expressions that frightened Joshua. Christiana must have noted his fear, for 3 times she pulled him close to her and said in a low voice, "You are mine now as much as Samuel. I will see to your care as I would my own born flesh." Jack Byram did not walk near his offspring, but farther back in the processional, among other women and children. Occasionally, Joshua would turn and look for him, and each time he noted Byram's look of pure fear. That did nothing to make Joshua feel better, and eventually he quit looking at his father at all, telling himself that he did not care what happened to Jack Byram in any case. It was a lie, and he knew it. Even if Jack Byram was ultimately responsible for Hester's death,
Even if he wasn't a good father, he was still the only father he had and his only blood link to the life he had known before. That counted for something, even if he wished it did not. When the refugees reached a meadow where Cane Creek flowed into the Tolico River.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.